Okay. Our next speaker is Uttam. And Uttam is from Pune. He works in SinnerZip right now. And he contributes to InfluxDB sometimes. And he's was a C++ programmer, now working in Go. He's an accidental textile business owner. Or rather, he's an accidental software engineer who would have made a wonderful textile business owner. So Uttam, stage all yours.
Thanks. Okay. Hi. Hello, everyone. And thanks for giving me this opportunity to speak here. Yeah, so we'll talk about web services in Go. As a C++ programmer, I have worked on desktop product application developments. However, when I started in Go, there was a requirement for creating a web service, and I started learning Go with that. So I will share my experience, and I will cover how we can do it in Go. Okay. So the agenda is, we'll see what is REST. Maybe most of you already know, but it was new to me. That's why I am covering this. We'll see what's the advantage of doing this in Go. We'll cover example of web service and how we can test web service in Go, how we can secure our web service using JWT.io, and how we can host the web service. So W3C defines a web service like this. It's a way to the machines over network interact each other. Okay. So typically a web service would look like this. There is a client, a server, and the GET request, student 78 score. So the URL is always like a folder structure, like you are accessing a folder, a file in a folder. That's how the URL should look like. And the response is most often it's JSON. Okay, it can be XML as well. So that's a typical web service. So REST. So REST was introduced by Roy Fielding in 2000. REST means representational state transfer. It is based on four principles. Okay, use HTTP methods explicitly. So these are the four methods: post, get, put, and delete. So these represents the CRUD operations. So what it means is, if we want to implement REST, post should always just add a resource, get should always get a resource, put should be used for update, and delete for delete. So if we are not following that, then it is not a REST service. Second principle, be stateless. So we will see another example of what stateless means here. Expose directory structure like URI. So every REST URL should look like directory structure like that. And it can transfer XML, JSON, or both. So these are the principles. So the question might occur, why REST? Okay. So essentially, it minimizes the coupling between the client and server. Client becomes resilient to the server changes. And also, there may be question, then why not write everything in REST? Because REST exposes the data through URIs, it's not safe to exchange the data which is secure, like financial transactions, banking sites. They don't really use REST there. They use SOAP protocol. So what's the difference between stateful and stateless? So let's take this simple example. Somebody wants to fetch a page from a book. There is a GET request. Client requests the page in the web service. There is a logic that it maintains the page counter, it increments the page and returns the next page. In this case, the server has to remember which client wanted which page, and it has to maintain the state. So this is stateful. Compare this with stateless. Here, the request is explicit. So the request would look like book page 2. Okay, just give me page 2. So there is no question of maintaining state. The request is explicit itself. So the next thing is Go advantage. Okay. So the advantages, there may be many, but I find them these very useful. First of all, single binary. So compared to other frameworks where The dependencies have to be managed dynamically. You have to download something at runtime and then set up things. Go is very easy. You just compile everything at static time, create a single binary, deploy it, and you're done. So that saves a lot of time. Performance of Go. So because of the built-in concurrency the net HTTP offers with the listen and serve method, you don't really have to do much to achieve high performance. And garbage collection makes the things very easy for the programmer. Okay, you don't have to dabble with malloc or alloc, things like that. Okay. So we'll see a basic web service. So this web service handles inventory of IP addresses. So you can store IP address and fetch the IP addresses. It uses net HTTP for listen and serve method, which handles the concurrent request. I have also used Gorilla Mux for parameterized routing because the standard library net HTTP doesn't provide that. And OS and buff.io are used just for file handling. Okay. The code is available on the link I provided. I will just show some snippets. Okay. So let's build this service now. First, we need to add the handlers. So it adds the routes and the handler. So you just need to define the route. In this case, IP alloc slash a pattern I have specified here. So it is expecting that the every IP address should start with 1.2 dot followed by two numbers there. And this is the handler get service, get device by IP handler. Okay. And I'm restricting it to accept only get methods. So that's why the get is called. Similarly for post method, that's the post method where new IP addresses can be added. Now let's look how the handler for get request look like. Okay. So in this case, it being a get request, the data is fetched from the vars variable, IP address. We are using IP ADDR there because we have specified in the handle func route that IP ADDR, that variable we have specified there, that's what we are using in the vars. We set some headers in the response writer using the w.header.set. Access allow origin, that is needed because I was testing with AngularJS front end, and if we don't use it, you will get coarse error, coarse origin error. That's why that's needed. After the headers are set, the device is fetched. If there are no error, it will just write the response using the json.encoder. Okay, I have not shown the complete code, but I think that's it. So that's about the handler for get request. Next, look at the post request. So the difference between get and post is for post, we get a body. So we have to read the data from the body. Error handling part is omitted to keep it brief. So first, the request is unmarshaled. If there are any error that is handled, then it is the get device by IP. So that check is there to just check if it is already added or not. And if everything is fine, just write the device to the file. Okay, that's about the post request. Now, just see how it works. So I'm using curl for testing. So first I start the web service, it starts listening on 8123 port. Then I post a request using curl xpostd, the data is like that. Device 8 IP address, that's the URL. When I do a get request, it returns the JSON response for that. Okay. So that was a simple web service I created, and it's available on GitHub if anybody is interested. Next is how do you test this? Okay. So Go provides very good test packages, and test and HTTP test, only two are needed to test your web service. So all tests are to be written with a underscore test.go file. You can use test main to write your setup and teardown code. And every test has to start with a test prefix. When you run go test, it runs all the tests. When we want to see the test coverage, we can run get test, go test cover. It shows the coverage. So this is an example how you write a test. In this case, it is just testing a simple prospect all route. So the arguments to this http.newRequest, first the method get post like that. We can specify the URL. And third is used, if you have a post request, then you also have to pass the body. So for that, the third argument used. Then we create a response writer using HTTP test.newRecorder. And we call serve HTTP. So that executes the request and collects the response. And we can check the response using w.code. And if we want to check the body, we can use w.body.string. That's how we can check the responses. Okay. So we have seen how to write a web service and how to test it. Now let's see. So this example we saw was open service. So anybody can just connect and get the responses. However, we want to make our service secure. So we can add jwt.io to do that. Okay. So JWT is essentially JSON Web Tokens. It's an open standard by RFC 7519 that defines a compact and self-contained way for securely transmitting information between parties as a JSON object. Okay, so it has library support for many languages, including the ones I listed here. It supports many other languages as well. So JWT has a simple structure. There are three components. There is a header, a payload, and a signature of the dot-separated header and payload. Okay, so the demo is available on that GitHub. So typical workflow would look like this. There is a client, a web service. First, the client has to send a post request with the username and password. So this authentication can be like OAuth 2 or HTTP basic authentication. So that information is exchanged. With this, the web service will respond with HTTP 200 OK, and it passes a JWT token. Now, the advantage is, with every subsequent request, the client has to send this JWT token along with the GET request or POST request, whatever request is there. So in this particular case, it is accessing the book page too, and it's setting the header with the JWT token. On the other side, web service will first validate the JWT token, and if only the token is valid, it will respond with a response. Otherwise, it will say unauthorized access. So this is how we can make the a web service secure. So the code for this is again very simple. First, you create a token using jwt.new. So to use JWT, you need a JWT Go package. Okay. Inside that, you have this jwt.new method. So we saw that it requires a header, payload, and a signature. So jwt.new with the signing method 256, that creates the header part. Then we set some claims like issued at time and expiry time. So expiry time is 1 hour. So the token will be valid from the generation time till only 1 hour. So that's the payload part. And we sign it with a secret. Okay. So that's how a token is created. And when it comes to parsing the token, it has to get the get authentication, because I have set the header as authentication. So that gives the JWT string. And JWT.parse takes that JWT string, and the second is the anonymous function, lambda we can call it. So that function will do validation, and JWT.parse, once the validation is done from JWT parse, it internally calls this function as well. And in this function, we are checking the signing method and if the algorithm is set or not. Okay, that's what we check and return the secret. So at the end, if the token is valid, it returns true. Otherwise, it will give a false. Okay, so that's how the parsing is done at the service side. So the thing to remember is the secret is the signature, that's the key used here. So that is known only to the client and server. So nobody else can sniff and get this information. Okay, so how to test it using curl, the simple demo I had. So I run the service on a port 3080. I send a post request. So that part is a base64 encoded username and password. I used a simple authentication. So after that authentication, the client gets this JWT token. Now with a new request, it has to, the client sets this token in the header part and it invokes book page 2 and the service responds. That's it. Okay, so that's how JWT is used. So the next thing is how do you host it? So there are many other options. I chose Heroku because it was free and easy. Okay, so you just have to sign up, install a tool belt, you create a Go web app. GoDeb is used for dependency management. So when we are working on a standalone machine, we get the dependencies using GoGet and the, build our binary. However, when we want to deploy, we can use GoDeb, which bundles all the dependencies together and keeps in a folder. So that's why we need a GoDeb here. And then just push to Heroku. We have to also set the port. Yeah, so the detailed information is available on that link. And you are running. Okay, so that's it. Thanks.
Is there any way I can apply the routes, the mapping of the route in the handlers in a declarative fashion? For example, in Java, you'd use annotations. In Python, you'd probably use a decorator type approach. So how would I go about mapping those in a declarative fashion instead of doing it in an imperative way? And in the same way for security, like if I want to protect some routes and I don't want to protect some, so how would I go about doing that in Go?
No, I don't know.
Okay, honest answer.
Sorry. I have not used it, so in a declarative way, I have not used it.
Right, you should help him out later on. Any other questions? I thought so.
Okay.
Time for tea, but thanks a lot, Uttam.
Okay, thanks.